nice introduction. Welcome. And I'm going to talk about topology optimization. This is something which has attracted my interest for a couple of years now. And so we have worked together with a number of people from TU-Delft, Copenhagen, and also Munich. Without them, the presentation here would not have been possible. The talk builds upon or shows results from some recent work we have done together. two paper in IEEE TDCG 2016 and 17, and another contribution to computer-aided design in 2016. I may skip the middle one here just because of the lack of time, but yeah, we will see. So first of all, what is topology optimization? Just let me try to explain this by means of a little toy problem. So let us assume you have 60 Lego blocks. You have a discrete grid like this one here, and now you want to just place these Lego blocks into the grid so that the resulting shape is stiffest. And what do we mean by stiffest? Well, we could say that the resulting shape is most resistant against the force which is applied here. So it is clear that the design space is quite large, right? We cannot just go over all the different possible solutions and test them individually. So we need some other kind of machinery to let the computer figure out the stiffest shape automatically. And here are just a few designs which could come up out of the large number of possible designs. And the question is then, first of all, how do we actually measure the stiffness of the resistance with respect to external forces? And we can do this in the following way. Here we have pretty much the same designs, but just as a higher resolution. And then what we can do is we can just apply an external load, and we can just look at the displacement which is induced by these loads. And now we can see which one of those designs here is the stiffest one. It seems that the one here is most resistant against the force which is externally applied to the structure. And this is, so to say, what topology optimization tries to do. Topology optimization tries to optimize the topology of a certain shape, or a given shape, in such a way that it is most resistant to particular forces you induce externally. So the thing is just, or the topology optimization process is visualized here, where you see that automatically, starting with some initial design, the topology, the internal topology, is evolved automatically to the stiffest topology based on some internal magic of the topology optimization process. This internal magic can be posed as the classical topology optimization problem. So what we are going to do here in topology optimization is that we want to minimize this objective function here, which is simply the elastic energy in our deformable body. And we want to minimize this subject to a couple of constraints. Right? First of all, here we have the static equation of linear elasticity in our setting. Then we have design variables here, which can become solid or void, or 1 and 0. You see this here, they essentially indicate at which places in this discrete grid setting the material should be deposited, and in which other places it should not be deposited. And there typically comes another constraint into play, and this is the volume constraint, which tells you that, of course, you know that the stiffest design would be the design where all the cells are filled with a solid material, right? And now comes, probably the most important constraint, which tells that you only want to have an occupancy here of a certain percentage, right? Like, let's say, of the entire 100% solid material, you only want to use 40%. And now the question is how you can actually deposit the design variables here, the solid and void cells, in such a way that the final design becomes most resistant against the external force. That is what topology optimization does. It's just the workflow which is then computed. And this is important to know that this is an iterative process. So what you do is you're solving the static equation of elasticity here for the displacements depending on the material property given here by the stiffness matrix and the external forces you apply. Then you do a sensitivity analysis and an update of the design variables. Therefore, you essentially measure how sensitive a certain cell is, or the change of the material at a certain location in this grid here, how strongly it affects the final elastic energy. And then if the whole thing has not converged, then you just repeat this step. You again complete these basements, you do the sensitivity analysis, you redeposit the material, and so on. Okay, and this is clear, takes some while, because in every iteration, and you perform typically a couple of hundred or thousand iterations until convergence, in every iteration you have to solve a very huge system of equations. We are talking here about millions of design variables, so high resolution grids which we use to do topology optimization. And so the result again, information or some facts here about what we have done in our first paper on topology optimization. Well, we have looked at the problem from a computational point of view, and what we have seen is, and this is something which we really have to keep in mind, that topology optimization requires really high resolutions. It doesn't really make sense to do topology optimization on a low resolution grid structure, because the result you get out of this may be completely different than the result you get out of it if you run it at a higher resolution. Meaning, in order to get faithful results, you need to have millions of elements which you're going to simulate here. And so this, of course, causes extreme computational loads and in particular memory requirements, right? We're talking about grids of 1k cubed, for instance, and in every iteration you have to run a linear elasticity problem to solve this numerically. You have to do the optimization by redepositing the material, and this is just not only computationally intensive, but it's also memory intensive. And so in addition, what comes into play here, that the solver convergence, which you typically use in order, if I go back to this one here, in order to solve the linear elasticity problem, the converging of classical solvers is rather bad, because you have some kind of, let's say, discontinuity in these design variables, these hard jumps from 0 to 1, right? And these make typical solvers for this kind of problem having very bad convergence. And also, if we want to increase additional constraints, and I show a couple of constraints which we have integrated into topology optimization, then this even increases the computational load, meaning that classical solutions, I would say, simply failed with respect to scalability. So what we have proposed in our first paper was just the embedding of this kind of topology optimization into a high-performance multi-grid solver. And the key idea, I don't want to go into the details of this, the key idea here was that we said, okay, how can we avoid memory lookup appropriations on the finest resolution levels? And we essentially came up with an idea to perform in-place computations instead of pre-computing per element stiffness matrices, for instance, and storing them at the finest level. This gave us an incredible speed up, because the amount of memory that has to be touched in every iteration just goes down dramatically. We also have thought about how to directly transfer quantities in this multi-grid cell level, in this multi-grid cell setting, which goes from coarse levels down to fine levels and vice versa, meaning that it always transfers quantity between different resolution levels. We came up with a nice mechanism in order to do direct transfer of the quantities, not level-wise, but by jumping across sets of levels to, increase memory access operations and also numerical operations. And then we also thought about how to incorporate other constraints, like minimum thickness constraints or symmetry constraints, into the topology optimization setting. Just a few examples. Now, first of all, the pipeline, just to give you a better feeling of what we perform here. So we typically start with a polygon model, and the user then specifies the external forces indicated here by the blue arrows. Then we voxelize the polygon model just into a set of millions of little voxels. These are then hexahedral simulation elements, which we use further on in the elasticity simulation. Then comes here the core of the topology optimization process, the multi-grid strain solver, the shape optimizer, including constraints. This now runs in a couple of hundreds or even thousand iterations until at the end the optimized shape or the optimized topology comes out of it. And this can then be just meshed into a final output surface and rendered using classical computer graphics techniques. Some examples demonstrating what comes out of this automatic optimization process. For instance, here, how the roof structure has been created. Well, we essentially specified the shape of the roof. Then we just specified a solid block of material beneath the roof. And then we said, okay, there might be some forces acting on top of the roof, pointing downwards, and topology optimization automatically generates then these support structures. Of course, an additional constraint here was that only 40%, if I remember correctly, of the solid material being placed underneath the roof should be used. And then topology optimization grows automatically these support structures here in a way they can see here. For the kitten as well, the external loads are given as the arrows, and you see that automatically now these support structures here essentially guiding the internal stresses along the main directions and while removing much of the material in between here, and this then adds to the shape we see here on the left-hand side. Some more examples, this classical cantilever example here. Again, we started with a solid disk, okay, and then we said we want to keep only 40% of the material, we want to apply a force here. How does the optimized structure look like? And this is, so to say, the ground, or the one of the most prominent test cases in topology optimization, for which one can prove theoretically that this is really the optimal structure. Some other examples here where we have area forces, meaning that along the boundaries of the two-dimensional plate here, we apply forces indicated by the blue arrows. And here, in addition to the forces indicated by the blue arrows, you also have a point force acting here. And you see how topology optimization evolves to fairly different shapes depending on the external loads which are applied. Here we have included a minimum thickness constraint, which is important if you finally want to print the structure. While you want to avoid to have structures which are too thin because the printing device cannot print it. So what can be done here is to induce this minimum thickness constraint into the simulation, and automatically then a shape evolves, which is of course not as resistant anymore as the shape you have here, but which do not have any internal structures below a prescribed minimum thickness, right? Meaning that this thing is still optimized by means of topology optimization, but now it is enforced that the structures cannot be thinner than a prescribed threshold, and this essentially means that you can finally print the thing on the printing device available. So, yeah, some other examples here for the kitten, just to show how different the structures look if you apply different external forces. Here the point forces, which we indicate at the selected position, then here area forces acting on the boundary of the surface in the direction of the inverse normal at each surface point, and then here the mixture of these forces being applied all together. And interestingly, if you look at the structures which come out here, this already looks very similar to the classical honeycomb structures, which are very often used in engineering when it comes to the design of lightweight material parts. Also some statistics concerning the resistance of the resulting shapes. Just as one example, for instance, we have compared topology optimization to a method which has been proposed, I think, 2013 or 14 by Rüdiger, where they explicitly did this kind of honeycomb structures by means of a kind of a Voronoi tessellation of the interior of the shape. And by means of topology optimization, if you look, for instance, on the percentage of solid material we use, we see here, for instance, we use exactly the same amount of material, but we are about twice as good as this method here with respect to the resistant. And if you look at the maximum strain which occurs in the internal, in the interior of the object, then you see that also topology optimization in this case here is far better than what has been proposed in this method. And here, of course, the nice thing is that it runs completely automatic. You just specify the forces, you specify a few additional constraints, and then you get automatically what you see here. So yeah, some more results just to demonstrate that topology optimization can also somehow guide it towards aesthetically pleasant shapes. This was something we are actually also trying to figure out how far we can go when not only the optimality with respect to external loads and the resistance comes into play, but if you have also shape constraints that someone says, okay, I want to create a shape which looks pleasant, which looks convincing, how can I combine this now with topology optimization to still keep it highly resistant? And here just a few examples demonstrating this, where we have tried to also generate compelling 2D and even 3D shapes, for instance, by also including symmetry constraints and a few others, especially here for the 3D objects. So, yeah, as I said, I think due to time constraints, let me just skip the middle part here. It's essentially where we have looked into, well, just to give you a brief idea, we have looked into ways to avoid support structures in 3D printing. And support structures are always are necessary if you have so-called overhangs, right, which do not stand on their own. So during the printing process, then you have to place support structures which are finally removed, right? And we came up with a nice, I think, adaptive technique using rhombic cells and an adaptive tessellation or adaptive refinement of the interior just by means of these rhombic cells. And the nice thing is, if this is the printing direction, additive manufacturing, for instance, if you use these rhombic cells oriented in the way you see them here, you will never have to use any support structures because overhang angles can simply not occur when using these rhombic cells. Here's so the process. What you do is you just start with one rhombic cell, and then you adaptively refine this cell to the shape boundary of the given object, and then you further optimize by doing adaptive refinements and taking into account, very similar to the classical topology optimization, the internal strain distribution of the object. Just a result, for instance, here on the right-hand side, this thing has also been printed. It can also be shown that it performs quite well compared to alternative techniques, with the advantage that you do not have to take care at all about these kind of overhang constraints for which you then might have to use support structures. So now let me come to the last example here. This is research which essentially came out of a collaboration with orthopedics. So they were investigating bone-like structures, and one particular reason they were investigating these structures was that they want to create implants which are lightweight, right, but which are still resistant to the external loads induced by the weight or by the muscles, or whatever other external loads are applied during, for instance, a walking process. And if you look at bone, and here you see a microscan cross-section of a human femur performed. This is not a microscan, this is really a cross-section of a human femur. And what you see is, and this is known, that the bone grows over the year in a particular way. Specifically, the bone follows the principal stress directions. So here you have such an illustration. So you have here an external load. This comes from the weight of the body. You have another external load, which is pulling. This comes from a muscle. And now if you look at the bone, you see that the bone has grown, in particular, along the major strain directions in the interior, which is caused by the external loads. And now the question is whether this kind of bone growth inspired by a natural evolution process can be simulated by means of topology optimization. And now if you just do what I have shown here, that you just create a bone model, a solid model, you say you want to only keep 40% of the solid material, you apply the point forces, then what comes out of this is what you see here. Okay, this is the dynamic evolution of the internal topology. And you see that this is not really how the bone looks like. Okay, you have one major strand here, another one here, and some other bigger strands along which, so to say, the main stresses are guided. Okay, and if you look at the bone, you see that the bone looks different. The bone looks, if you would zoom in further, you would see that the bone already almost looks like kind of a hexahedral mesh, okay? With some with the mesh edges grown along the principal stress direction, but also some other supporting structures orthogonal to this in three dimensions. And the question then is, can we also add additional constraints into topology optimization so that these kind of structures appear? And the basic idea behind this is as follows. We have thought about, how can we cope with this volume constraints? The volume constraint in classical topology optimization just says that I want to keep 40% of the material, right? But it doesn't make any constraints on how the material is actually being distributed, right? Another question was, can we just impose additional local constraints to avoid fully solid regions, as you see them here, for instance, right? And the idea is, yeah, we can, by just saying we add local volume constraints. Now we just say, okay, such a local volume constraint just tells us that at every point in the simulation domain, by looking in a certain surrounding indicated by this support here, we want to only have a certain percentage of filled cells, right? And this would then tell that we don't want to have this kind of big filled regions here, but we rather want to have a fairly regular distribution of the material so that not only is the structure optimized with respect to one point force applied here and here, but also with respect to other forces which occur, for instance, if you move, right? So, and the problem with this constraint is then that this embedding this into a topology optimization gives a problem, because you have a constraint now for every design variable, meaning that you have too many constraints. You could say just take a maximum constraint, right? But this constraint is not differentiable anymore, meaning the sensitivity analysis, which tells you how to redistribute the material, cannot be done anymore, because therefore you need to get the differentiability of the underlying quantities. Otherwise, the optimization algorithm doesn't work anymore. And we came up now with a means to cope with this. So what we do is we simply use the p norm of the maximum operator here, which then essentially gives us a single constraint which is differentiable, and this can then nicely be integrated into the objective function of topology optimization, so that the local constraints with respect to the maximum prescribed local density, so to say, of the material can be ensured. And also here some examples demonstrating this, how the structures, the topology of the structures now differs. For instance, this is now the same simulation you saw before, but now with this local density constraint being imposed on the variables. And you see now that you do not have this one big strand here going down along the principal stress directions, regarding the load which is applied here. But now what happens that the constraint tells, okay, no, I don't want to have these big strands in the topology, but rather they should be split, they should be subdivided into smaller ones, and in particular automatically also structures orthogonal to the major strands oriented here downwards and also here in this region are generated. Some more examples, for instance this one here, a plate, a 2D plate, where we have applied external loads here on the right-hand side, and also the dynamic topology optimization process, now with this local constraint imposed, and you see it looks almost like an automatically generated quadrilateral grid, of course, not accurately, right? I mean, you have still parts here, for instance, where you don't have these kind of bridge-like structures, but in other parts here, the evolution is quite nicely along the major and the second largest stress direction in the internal wall strain fields. Yeah, another example here, also for a 2D plate, and I just let the dynamics run here in order to see how the topology optimization process iteratively evolves the structure until then the final design is generated. Yeah, and so we can also do statistics on these structures here, and maybe the most interesting statistics, and this is one of the last things I want to say here, the bone-like structures which we see here are significantly stiffer in case of force variations, and this is a really big advantage. Topology optimization, in a classical sense, at least, deals with point forces, and then it optimizes the topology with respect to these point forces. Now, the reason why the bone grows as it grows is because there's not one single point force, but the force direction changes continuously. Whenever I do movements, right, I have point forces acting from different directions with different strength. And this is exactly what this kind of local volume constraint considers. And if we now just orient, for instance, the force being applied here, if we do this for the structure which has been generated by classical topology optimization and the structure we see here, then we see that this structure here gets a really bad, bad resistance measured here by the C prime, and the resistance of the structure here remains almost the same, so even getting a little better when you change this point force here, now acting from a different direction. It's also more resistant in case of material deficiencies, so if you just take out something here and there, then you also see that in this case here, so the stiffness becomes really bad, and in this case here, the stiffness becomes a little worse, but not that much. I mean, we are now about a factor of two better than in this case, where you have used the structure evolving from classical topology optimization, and we have now simulated a material deficiency by taking out one piece of it. Yeah, and the whole thing can also be done in 3D, of course. This is the 3D model we have generated in this way, just by using exactly the same approach as I have just illustrated and demonstrated in 2D. Now in 3D, and you see very nicely that these kind of, let's say, hexahedral grid-like structures come out here. In some other regions, they do not come out so clearly. It's interesting now to figure out why is this so, and it is also interesting to figure out whether maybe by means of this technique we could generate real hexahedral meshes, like wireframe structures, following the principle of stress direction in the interior, and use them, for instance, later on for doing other kinds of simulations on the three-dimensional object. So, yeah, just some statistics, but I think I'm almost running out of time here. Just some prints. We have also printed these things just to show that they can be printed. And we have also put them, what's the name of them? They can put pressure on something and pressure until they break, in order to figure out that the shapes are really optimized, that this is not only of interest theoretically, but also under practical work conditions, the optimization holds. So in the future, what is ongoing work we will pursue? Well, first of all, as I said, we are actually talking to orthopedics to think about implant design. Can we use this kind of topology optimization, improved topology optimization, to automatically design implants which look similar to how the real bone structures look? We want to also look deeper into how bone is grown. What I have just said is only one part of the truth. I mean, bone growth is much more complicated than what I have stated here. It's kind of a hierarchical process where you have a couple of layers, hierarchical layers, which are somehow evolving together and interacting with each other. We want to go into this and look how topology optimization can essentially simulate this. And then we also want to apply topology optimization in soft rubber design structures. With respect to visualization, and this is one of the reasons why I'm here, I need help here from Bruno. We want to look into how a topology optimization can be used for visualization purposes, like the hexahedral kind of grid structure, which comes out of a topology optimization, might serve as a good 3D visualization to indicate the internal stress distribution of a 3D body under load. And maybe we can use this and build hexahedral meshes, which somehow follow the structures I have shown here. That is the reason why I want to talk to Bruno about whether hexahedral meshes can somehow be coupled with this kind of topology optimization approach. Then another thing which is very interesting in my opinion, at least from a visualization point of view, so far I would say that the dynamics of topology optimization is not very well understood. Okay, so we see that there's something evolving and at the end something comes out which is optimized. But there's not much understood about how this dynamical evolution process, what it does, why it does so, how it can be tweaked into different directions. And my personal impression is that maybe 3D visualization or the dynamics of topology optimization could help here in order to understand this process better and make it more steerable by then looking at how it behaves dynamically if you apply or if you add additional constraints into the solution processes. Yeah, that's it for now. Thank you for your attention. And of course, I'm open for questions. Thank you.